We're still there. The Lord's been fueling me in the morning times as I seek His face and asking Him to help us with this Bible study. I just feel like the Lord has really poured this into my spirit. So, Habakkuk 2, 2, and 3. If you can find it back there in the back of your Bible. Well, I say in the back of your Bible, in the middle of your Bible, at the end of the Old Testament. Habakkuk 2, 2, and 3. I want you to take these scriptures home and meditate upon them. Father, I thank You for the privilege of breaking holy bread, God, Your word. I pray for wisdom and knowledge tonight that the Holy Ghost will lead me, guide me, and direct me. Lord, the abundance of my heart, my mouth will speak. My heart may be filled with love. Lord, edify Your body tonight with the gift of preaching. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We talked about, for those who weren't here last Wednesday, we talked about having a dream and having a vision. Oh, I felt like that's what the Lord laid upon my heart. And we'll read these verses of scriptures over every time, Lord willing. Next Wednesday probably be the men's ministry, I suppose. I don't know that to be certain, but it's getting close to the end of the month. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie, though it tarry, wait for it, because it will surely come, it will not tarry. Those are some promising words there. For visions. And I can't go through individual visions because there should be a lot of visions in this church tonight. If you don't have dreams, if you don't have visions, if you don't have plans for your life, then, you know, I ain't going to say it's not worth living. But when you find yourself in life that don't have no plans, don't have no dreams, don't have no visions, you're probably depressed. Amen? Something has hindered you. Maybe you think just because you ain't got a whole lot of money, you can't have visions. The devil is a lie. Amen. Amen. You don't have to have all kind of money to have visions. How many knows God uses people with a couple loaves of bread and a few fish? You don't have to have a whole lot. I believe everyone that's ever accomplished anything in life had to start somewhere. You don't start off on top. You work your way to the top. And if you go to the top without working your way to the top, you won't appreciate it when you get there. I feel something here already. Amen? You got to work your way to the top. And that doesn't mean that you get to the top and look back and brag about all that you've done. There will be some times in between the bottom and the top that you'll learn to lean on Jesus. When you get to the top, you'll look back and say, if it had not been for the Lord that was on my side, I'd have never made it to where I'm at. So God wants to dream with us. God wants to vision with us. We've been saved for a purpose. Don't get complacent in your walk with the Lord. That's where a lot of people backslide. They get complacent. I've done been saved. I've done been to the river. I've done been filled with the Holy Spirit. I've done joined the church. I've already become a teacher. I've already done this. Never come complacent with God. Amen. Regardless, God called me as a pastor and a young man, but I'm still not complacent today. I'm still growing. I'm still wanting to grow closer to God. I may want to get closer to the Lord tonight. Amen. I don't care how old you are, how crippled up you are, how long you've been living for Jesus Christ. Today is the day of salvation. How many knows He's got something new in store today that He didn't do yesterday? Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And it just thrills my heart to seek Him. We talked about last Wednesday night about hearing from the Lord. Verse number 2 is where we're starting off at. And the Lord answered me. Okay. He answered you. If He didn't answer you, don't go after. Amen? Yeah. There's a lot of people out there going for things that the Lord ain't said go for. Your life is too short. I don't care if you do live to be 100. Your life is too short to be playing games. Amen. How many has ever seen people that live for the devil half of their life and then they're half dead before they want to live for Jesus? Then they ain't worth nothing. Can't breathe, can't walk. Sin has taken a toll on their bodies. They were looking for love in all the wrong places. Amen. Right. Amen. But tonight, we're not going to talk about hearing from God. We're going to talk about obeying God. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision. All right, the Lord's answered you. You need to pray about your individual vision. But as far as this church is, there must be a corporate vision. Amen? Amen? I believe every organization, every church, every business, everything should have a mission statement. What's a mission statement? That means you're going somewhere. When you walk into those doors at Oak Grove Assembly of God, if you're a part of this family, you ought to know where we're going. People ought to know where we're going by just watching us. Amen? We ought to be in unity. We ought to, hey, now look, 80-something people that come in Sunday morning, you can hang it up to get all of them in unity. You can hang it up to get all of them in the vision. But this remnant that comes faithful, this remnant that wants to be discipled, tonight God is challenging us to pull together as a body of Christ. He's called us to pull together and obey God.
Amen.
And everybody in here tonight has a purpose in the body of Christ. Individually, you have to seek the Lord for your own visions. But corporately, a vision should go through the pastor. A pastor should have the vision. Amen? If the pastor has to ask the congregation for a vision, he's not much of a pastor. Why should the pastor only have the vision? Well, where do you have your eyes at? Where are they mounted to? Your head. Amen? Who's the head of the church under Jesus Christ? The pastor. Anybody that's got two heads is a deformed body. Uh-oh, I'm not going to get into a sermon about authority. But anyone that has two heads, they're either Siamese twins or they're a deformed body. And the pastor should have the vision. But let me tell you something. You can't fulfill a vision with your eyes. All you can do is see it afar off. But it takes the body to bring it into reality. You hear what I'm saying tonight? So just as vital as the pastor with his eyes and his vision to see and to hear what God has for a corporate body of Christ, just as important is the fingers and the toes and the arms and the legs that helps bring the vision to fruition tonight. Amen?
Amen.
Write the vision. Why would he tell us to write the vision? It's obedience. I want to talk about obedience tonight. Our mission statement at Oak Grove, for those that don't know it, we used to have a shirt. I wore it today. Mama faced it, had a hole in it. I reckon it was under my arms or something. I couldn't see it. It's all them big muscles, Mama face. I don't supposed to lie behind the pulpit. I don't supposed to lie at all. Amen. Let's say big double whoppers then, size muscles. There all kind of giggles going on then. Obedience, the mission statement that was on the shirt says, how many knows our mission statement? Please tell me somebody who knows. To know who you are in Christ and to serve in that position. Ain't that a wonderful mission statement? There are all type of mission statements. Some churches have mission statements of feed the hunger. And that should be part of us, don't get me wrong. But our total vision, I sought the Lord for this, I prayed about this, and this is our mission statement. Everybody on every pew tonight needs to know that. If you're part of this body, you need to know who you are in Christ. Just because you're someone, you need to quit trying to be who your neighbor is in Christ and be your own self. Because God has got some unique qualities about you that nobody can be you but you. And if you quit trying to do everybody else and act everybody else's part and just be you, you'll find it's so much easier to be you.
Amen.
Be you. Some folks ask me why I'm crazy behind the pulpit. I said, I'm crazy everywhere. I'm just me. And it's easy to get behind the pulpit and be me. Amen. God called me to be who? Me. Obedience. Here we go. John chapter 14, verse 15. Let's turn there. John chapter 14. Let's find out how important obedience is tonight. John 14, verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. Verse 23 of the same chapter says, Jesus answered and said to him, if a man love me, he will keep my words. And my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father which sent me. obedience 2 weeks ago, three weeks ago, and this just thrilled my heart the other night, or that day, because that lets me know that I'm still in tune with heaven. Although I don't flaunt it, I don't try to bring recognition to me, especially during a service like that, because for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. Jesus Christ gets all the glory. But three Sundays ago, I'm preaching, and God's just, he has gave me the gift of a word of knowledge, of a word of wisdom. I can see names sometimes. I can see who God is dealing with sometimes. And he'll just lay it on my heart. And sometimes I speak it, sometimes I don't. Because many times when I speak it, people don't obey the Lord. And they just walk out of here and then they'll let me know later on, boy, that message was for me. And I'm like, okay, why didn't you obey the Lord? But anyhow, three Sundays ago, there was a family come here. And I don't want to say no names, but anyhow, I gave an altar call, and the Lord just, I mean, out of all the people here, the Lord said, I'm dealing with so-and-so's heart. Keep prolonging the altar call. I'm like, okay. So I keep prolonging. I could have called their names out, but I didn't. Number one, I don't do that. The only way I'm going to do that is if God, he better speak loud and clear before I call someone's name out. But I kept on and kept on, and then there was somebody over here praying, so I went over here and prayed, and the next thing you know, I looked up, and there so-and-so was in the altars, and it was so good to know out of all the remnant of people in a Sunday morning service that God can single one soul out and speak to his leader and say, I'm dealing with this soul, keep inviting them to the altar. They've been back every Sunday since then, brought a slew of children with them, and if I would have missed that, and just said, you know, forget it. Don't nobody want to come to altar. Let's shut it off. Who knows? Do you see how important it is to obey God?
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't obey when you want to. You obey when he says something. It's then.
Yeah.
How many of you have ever spoke to your child, tell them to go do something, and they say, well, just wait a minute till the TV's still off. No, if I told you to do something, do it now. If I wanted you to do it after your TV show went off, I'd have told you and gave you instruction to do it when Andy Griffith goes off. Come on, somebody. Mm-hmm. Going to Mississippi one day, preaching revival. Sister Mary Watford's my mentor, 90-something years old, grew up in this church. So that tells you about how old this church is. Some parts of it anyhow. I got an hour and a half, 2 hour drive one way, hour and a half, 2 hour drive another way, and I got all this time to glean wisdom from a saint of God that has confirmation on her life, that she's got a calling of miracles, signs, wonders. You just have to hear the testimonies of this lady. And I'm eager to know, young man, just started ministry, I'm eager to know what does it take to see all those things? Why are we the generation that's allowing the old-time religion to become a thing of the past and we don't see movings no more like we need to? Why? That makes me angry. I don't know about y'all, but people my age, that makes me angry that our generation is failing God. And God didn't call me out of the mess I was living in just to accept that. He called to stir up something within inside of me that I might can tell more people my age to let's seek God to have the same type of movement or a better movement because Jesus Christ is still the same.
Great.
And I asked her the question. I said, Sister Mary, what does it take to see an outpouring of God's Spirit? I just knew she would say something like fasting, reading your Bible so many times, go visit the sick. Da 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 da. She sat there for a moment. She thought. She says, well, you know, child, she said, it takes a lot of praying. I'll say that much. Seeking the Lord. She said, but one thing of all the years that I've lived for the Lord that I have seen happen in church that causes God's Spirit not to move. I didn't ask her what caused it not to, but in order to know what causes it to move, you need to know what causes it not to move. And so she says there was one lady in her church that God would just pour out the Holy Ghost upon, and she would just have a just an awesome time in the Lord. And when the Lord would pour out his spirit upon her, it would just bounce upon everybody else in the service. How many knows that we got, some people's got keys to the service?
Yeah.
How many's been around Pentecostal long enough that people's got keys to the service?
Right.
And if you don't obey God, then you might mess up the whole service. And it would just jump from one to another, and this one would get blessed, and that one would get blessed. And it all started for one soul was obedient to God. And then people began to mock her, because I want to tell you right now, if you're going to have a close walk with God, if you're going to grow in Christ, you better get ready to be picked on.
Yeah.
You better be getting ready to get mocked. You gotta learn to stand to the face of your enemies that laugh at you and talk about you and ridicule what you've got. If you can't do that, then more likely you're not going to receive it. And as people begin to mock her and pick on her and run her down, she quit obeying God. And of all the things that she had seen, this is what she said. If you really want to see a moving of God, because God wants to bless all of his people, she said, just obey God. I'm thinking of all the books that they sell, this woman that's 90 years old, she's told me the key to seeing a powerful move. I believe there's saints in this sanctuary tonight that God wants to pour out his anointing, bless you with unspeakable joy, unspeakable and full of glory, and all we got to do is learn to obey him. That's it. Because we got it in our heads tonight that God hates us. We're not good enough. Come on, be honest with us. We're not good enough. We're steadily trying to get good enough for God. But if we could just learn to accept that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him. Whosoever. If we could comprehend the great love of God and how much he loves us. Besides going around with a condemned spirit all the time that he's after us. He's wanting to throw us in hell. Honey, if God wanted you in hell, you'd be there today.
Yes, right.
He's left you alive for a reason. You just don't know the power in obeying God. Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So you can't go around saying you love someone if you don't do they ask you to do. Amen?
Amen?
My wife says she get aggravated by my dirty socks being inside out. So what up? Look at Miss Judy. That's where she got it from. She said, every time I get ready to fold up clothes, the socks inside out. So, I got in a habit when I take my socks off, I grab them by the toes now. And now they're so stretched, it's pathetic. And then pull them off like that. Did I have to do that? But if I want peace at the house, that's a good start. That's a good start, amen? Back when there was another lady coming to church here one time, her and my wife got to talking one day, and then they got to talking about how bad men are by leaving the sinks full of water. Toothpaste. Don't dry it up. And everybody looking around. Every time I come in here to the sink, it's toothpaste all over the place. I'm like, okay. So I get my towel. I'm in a habit now of drying up the water in the toothpaste. And y'all say, boy, she's got you wrapped around her little finger, don't you? You can say what you want to, but I have to go home with this woman. You don't. Amen? And I love her. Come on, how many loves their wives? I love her. She leave me, I'm going with her. Come on, Miss Tom. Packing my clothes up, we're going together. Death do us part. Better for worse. And so if I love her, I'm going to do what I can to keep peace. Amen?
It's hard to do, though.
I knew I'd get y'all fired up. I want you to turn with me real quick, like to Proverbs 13 and 22, because there's a lot of obedience, but I felt the Lord driving this in my spirit this morning. Proverbs 13, verse 22. We're going to focus on this, and then we're going to go to Ecclesiastes, 2 points that I want to make sure I get in before if I don't get none of the rest of these scriptures in. Proverbs 13, 22. You need to write this down. Visions and dreams. There are some biblical dreams and visions and plans that you need to make without asking God anything. In other words, on our first Wednesday night, we were talking about praying and hearing from God. There are certain dreams that you definitely need to hear from God from. But if they're biblical, sound doctrine, there's no need in fasting and asking God to change His mind. He's already written it in stone. And this is one of them. Proverbs 13 and 22. A good man leaveth an inheritance to his children's children, and the wealth of the sinner is laid up for the just. Now, we need to be making plans to leave our family better off than what we are. Come on. Amen. Don't get quiet on me because I'm talking about resources. The Bible teaches us that we need to start planning for this. I mean, we plan for everything. And we're going to just go on to Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 3, because this all ties in together. Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 3, you need to circle these two, because these are dreams and vision you need to put in your budget. Budget? Yeah, I said budget. Most of us are rather young in the church tonight. We need to plan for that. Oh, Jesus is coming next week. Bye, Johnny. Well, if He don't come next week, you need to plan in case He don't. Well, that shows lack of faith. No, I don't. It shows wisdom. Amen? You be prepared. God wants to bless us sometimes, but sometimes we don't position ourselves to be blessed. How many knows anything about baseball? Center field, right field, left field. They got to be positioned to catch that ball. They got to be working together and calling the shot. Amen? Right. God wants to bless us, but if we won't position ourselves to be blessed, then it's hard to. Go ahead, Miss Becky, read that for me. Ecclesiastes, chapter 6, verse 3. Keep me from flipping some up.
And his soul be not filled with good, and also that he have no burial. I say that an untimely birth is better than
him. An untimely birth is better than man. He's harsh about it, ain't he? What did he say? He said, if you have no what? Burial. I didn't come to talk about dying, but let's face it, we're all going to die. This is the hardest thing for young folks to face. We don't plan for death. We don't try to get everything lined up for death because, you know, we're going to live forever, are we? We're going to live till we're 85, 90 years old, are you? What if death was to hit your home tomorrow? You ready? Are you spiritual ready? Are you financially ready? Are you going to have the church to take your love offering to put you in the... Don't get offended. Don't get offended tonight. But I see a lot of this. Yeah. I'm going to do what I can to help people out. I ain't talking about the dead. Amen? We're going to sow seeds, and if somebody needs an offering to put them in the ground, we'll do what we can to help them. But it shouldn't be like that. The preachers need to harp it from the pulpit that the Bible said you need to put up for your burial. You know you're going to die. When you're a grown man and you begin to have bills, I mean, he's got any of those. If you never raised your hand in church, you ought to raise your hand right there. It's mom and daddy's paying them for you. Must be. I ain't seen but one hand go up. Praise God. These kind of things need to be figured into your budget. Burial. You need some life insurance. Amen? Life insurance don't cost much, especially for young folk. Young folk can get life insurance cheap. Wait, you get old and got cancer, baby, you ain't got enough money in the bank to afford some life insurance. You hear me? And I will make this statement. It's a crying shame, and I believe some funeral homes are going to stand before God to count a judgment of how high and ridiculous it is to put somebody in the ground. But that's a whole other sermon. Whole other sermon. And that's not my judgment anyhow. They have to stand before God of how much money it costs to put somebody in the ground. It's awful. How many knows that one of your cheapest funerals is what? $5,000 to $8,000? What? To put somebody in the ground? That's cheap. That's an old pine box thrown over there in the dirt somewhere else. Come on. The more you go up, the more it is. I mean, it's ridiculous. Let me tell you something. We need to be as children of God. We need to be ready for that day.
Amen.
Feeling like I got people staring at me in all corners. We need to be ready for that day. Say that with me. We need to be ready.
Amen.
That's part of my vision. There ought to be some insurance company people ringing tomorrow. My preacher got on me last night. I don't have no life insurance. I'm going to get me some life insurance. Just get you some barrel insurance. You ain't got to go get a bunch of life insurance. You've watched Forensic Files. You know what happens when you get a bunch of life insurance. Especially if you're married. Just get enough to put you in the ground, man. You need to be hiding all that extra money under the stump and let your children know where it's at. Come on, somebody, help me preach, somebody. I know my baby ain't gonna kill me. She had to put up all them bills. Shout it, son. It's all the time. Anybody got any questions on those visions? I wanted to get a little bit more in. I felt the Lord press me in. I just be about willing to guarantee you the Holy Spirit has not talked to my spirit early this morning praying to mention that, because everybody in the room's got it. And I'm not singling you out. I'm not going to do that. But why would the Holy Spirit check me this morning and say, Brandon, make sure you mention this, that they need some burial. Because it's better than an untimely birth. I mean, it's worse than an untimely birth. Just be ready. And hey, by the way, you got family coming along. Think about them. And the best inheritance you can leave them is God's holy word. Amen. That mama and daddy was a praying mom and daddy. If you don't have no money to leave them something spiritually. Leave them a spiritual legacy that they can always remember. Mama went to church. Daddy went to church. Grandma went to church. They loved Jesus. Amen. When I think about mama and I think about daddy, they love the Lord.
Amen.
Anybody got any questions before we move on? Amen. Move on home. All right. Acts chapter 5, verse 32. For those that have been wanting the Holy Ghost, the filling of the Holy Ghost, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, for those that have been wanting that, I think this scripture helped you. And we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that obey him. Now, a lot of people call me mean, judgmental, this, that, and other, but don't only go by somebody talking in tongues in a service and say they got the Holy Ghost. If their lifestyle don't back it up, they can talk to their blue in the face, jibber-jabber, all they want to. God's not giving the Holy Ghost to a bunch of devils. Amen. God's giving the Holy Ghost to those who live right. Those who obey him, walk in his statutes. Jesus already done said, if you love me, what? Keep my commandments. So, you know, I mean, I'm not saying get self-righteous and try to earn something from God, because it's a gift. And if you don't watch it, you'll be trying to earn something from the Lord. But if the Lord lays something upon your heart, and you see, the New Testament people, which that's who we are, we have such a big rim to be judged by. We thought the old covenants was bad about the sacrifice of the doves and the pigeons. And no. Jesus didn't come to lower the standard. He came and raised the standard.
Right.
He said, unless your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Ain't that what he said? In Ezekiel, if I'm not mistaken, he prophesies about taking the, when Jesus comes, he'll take the old heart out and he'll put in a new heart of flesh. And he'll write his laws upon the tables of our heart. Now watch this. There are some laws that the Spirit of God gives you. He may not give me. That's why the scripture teaches us, let every man work out his own salvation with fear and trembling. Now, if it says it's in the book, it's a sin, it's a sin. Amen? But there are different levels of law that the Spirit of God will speak to you to do. He may got a vision that he wants to fulfill in your life. And if it's not my vision, well, obviously he's not going to tell me to do it.
Right.
And disobedience is sin. Can I give you an illustration of it? Thank you. I don't have a calling to preach to Nineveh. So therefore, he's not going to tell me to go get on a boat and go to Nineveh. But Jonah was called to preach to Nineveh. Amen? And Jonah got on the boat, but he went the wrong way. Now, where in the book does it say, thou shalt not go the wrong way on a boat? There's no commandment for that. There's no law for that. But it's written on the table of his heart because God's already called him to preach to Nineveh. And if God calls you to preach, you're going to be there. Oh, but Jonah wants to fight with the Lord. Don't we love doing that? If we're all honest and you know, just confess tonight, we're all guilty of disobeying God. But I'm just going to warn you, it's a fight that you don't want to get into. Not just to show you, preacher, that you can do what you want to do, or whoever else you're arguing with, you don't want to get God angry. Don't do that. He sends him a storm. Remember that? Everybody remembers that. What did Jonah do? He preached to Nineveh, didn't he? Should have went ahead and done it first, right? So, it's just a big realm that we're judged by. Every day, if you're saved, God communes with you. God speaks with you. He tells you things. And you may say, oh, it's just that little voice in my head. If you're saved and you really have a relationship with the Lord talks with you.
Amen.
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 He talks with you. He fellowships with you. And if he tells you to do something, even if it's, I don't know, I've been in some service where people will do some crazy things. I mean, there was one man one night that was in a service. The Lord spoke to him and told him to crawl. Just get up and go crawling over the by the altars. And the Lord poured out his anointing upon that, anointed that. One night we was gathered at a revival in New Haven Holiness Church. We got there and the minister was leading the service. He said, is everybody happy to be here? They went to clapping. And I don't know who the Lord dealt with to keep clapping. Because you know, after about, what is it, about 15 claps, that's when we stop. You know how it is. Somebody kept clapping. And that led everybody else to keep clapping. Because I'm going to tell you something. Attitudes are contagious. And that's why I talk to our leaders of our church more than I talk to anybody else. And I tell them, people are looking at us. And if we... train these new ones to do what we do. Let me ask you something. Is your attitude worth catching? Is your lifestyle worth catching? Because a lot of times, the people that are standing right beside you will follow you if you obey God. They'll follow you. See there? DJ wasn't fixing to clap. Brother Larry clap, DJ clap, Maul clap, three or four, just follow. Amen. Ain't nothing wrong with it. I ain't singling nobody out. We all should be clapping for the Lord. Amen. Give it. Look at that. It's amazing how we can follow one another. I think it's a crying shame when we leave our brothers hanging. He wouldn't be clapping by himself. Y'all help him out a little bit. Sometimes he keeps me going. Better than seeing him. That's what I see halftime. You never know how that feels till you get behind this thing and try to go speaking. Amen. So let people know that, hey, our attitudes are contagious. What we're doing, how we're obeying God, it's contagious. And if we're not disobeying God, it's contagious. Preach, would you preach sound doctrine? As sound as I know. Paul the apostle said this, know you not, a little leaven will leaveneth the whole lump. What is leaven? Leaven was a sign for what? Sin. Amen. A little bit of sin, you know how it is. That's why our church world age is where it's at now, because everything that used to be wrong ain't wrong no more. I'm preaching now. It ain't wrong no more. Sister so-and-so done it, and I know she got the good, so it's all right for me to do it. Brother so-and-so done it, I know it's all right. I believe every one of us should have our own sound convictions. Whatever the Lord is leading us, for as many as be led by the Spirit of God or the sons of God. How many tonight is being led by the Lord? The Lord is my shepherd. Whatever he tells me to do, that will I do. Look how crazy. Look how crazy obedience can get. Abraham is told to go kill his own son. God didn't want his son. He wanted to know right off the bat, before you follow me, will you obey me? Even when it hurts, even when it costs you something. It's easy to obey God when he tells you to throw $100 in the offering plate when you got about $2,000 bills in your pocket. Ain't nothing to that. Oh, but wait till he tells you to throw in $5 and that's all you got for the week. Now we're talking about some sacrifice. You obey the Lord then. Amen. It's hard to obey God when that's all you got. But a lot of times, I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, if you're going to step off with me into this Bible study that we're doing and really seek the Lord about visions in your life and quit procrastinating and quit just wasting the days of your life, God's got something for each and every one of us inside of this sanctuary. And I'm telling you, the quicker you get involved with a corporate vision that God's got for his body, he's going to bless your individual visions. If you'll bless the kingdom of God, he'll bless your visions. I ain't talking about financial anything. I'm talking about your physical body. Getting involved, getting your hands dirty, knowing who you are in Christ, and serving in that position, and more of all, be faithful.
Yeah.
Be faithful. Whatever God calls you to do, be faithful. Can't nobody depend on you. I've heard a lot of people say, so-and-so got this, and so-and-so got this calling on their lives, and so what good is it going to do them at home?
Right.
Can't use you at home. Can't use you at the beach. Anybody going to help me tonight?
Come on.
You leave your brothers and sisters hanging in Christ, it ought to break your heart. It ought to sadden your heart. No matter what kind of body part you are essential to this vision and this dream that God has blessed here. But don't get big headed, because if you ain't here, God will raise somebody else and put them. Amen. Let me make sure. I want to go to one last spot. I know y'all getting tired of hearing me. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 8. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 8. This is amazing to me. We're talking about Jesus Christ, y'all. Though he were a son, yet he yet learned. Somebody say learn. What's Jesus Christ got to learn? He knows it all. He's Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end. He's omniscient. He's all-knowing. What in the world has he got to learn? He learns. Why does the Bible say that Jesus Christ done things on earth? He done them for our example. How many remembers when his mother was looking for him and he had disappeared and he was over there with the doctors and teachers of the law and asking them questions and said, knew you not that I was about my father's business? Remember that? Why in the world would Jesus Christ sitting over there talking to religious people of that day trying to get educated? What? Jesus? How are you going to educate Jesus? He is the Word. You can't teach him the Word. The Word's in him. The Word is him. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word's with God, and the Word was God. Why did he do all that then? He done all that for an example. Because we're what? Christ-like. Be like Christ. Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience. How'd he learn it? Uh-oh. Let's don't read the rest of that. It just sounded too good before we read the rest of the verse. How'd he learn it? Suffering. We learn obedience by suffering. Talking to Mr. Griff Sunday evening, man, tears boiling up. Thought we was just going to have us a cry party right there in his living room. He began to tell me, because I had been very sick before, and I know what it's like to think that the next morning you wake up, you're going to die. I know, I've been there. And I asked him, because I always like to hear different people's perspective. I said, how do you keep your head up, Mr. Griff? And he said, brother, there's some hard days. He said, I try. He said, but it still gets me down sometimes. He said, but one thing about it, and you can just about ask anybody that really is suffering with some type of disease that long term, and they'll say this. I look at things now totally different. Why? Because you think that when people suffer like that, that their life is through with. But man, let me tell you something. They learn so much through suffering that some of us will never learn. Amen? And I don't want to have to go through that to learn. But I tell you what I can do. I can get along beside of those who are suffering. And weep with them. Come on, somebody. I prayed before I got there. I said, Lord, let me be a blessing to Mr. Griff. How many has ever prayed that before you get to visit somebody? Just say, Lord, let my visit be a blessing today. Yeah. Maybe you're going to visit somebody. It ain't got to be sick. Maybe it's just one of your church family you're going to fellowship with. Just say, Lord, let me be a blessing to them. And I believe he answered my prayer just sitting there. And I told him, I said, Mr. Griff, I don't have no words to tell you, except for the Bible. I said, but I'm just going to be here with you. Amen. Sometimes people don't need a whole lot of words. They just need to know I got your back. Amen. I'm here with you. If you want to cry on my shoulder, go ahead. If you're angry, you got questions, get angry. I mean, we get to these people that's going through these things, and we try to be like Job's friends. We try to tell them, this is why you got that, that's why you got this, and this is why that's happened, and that's why this happened. We don't need all of that. They don't need all that. All we need to do is to learn to weep with those who weep. Amen? When we learn to weep with those who weep, then we begin to learn what they learn. And I don't know about y'all, but I'd rather learn it through Jesus' cross that he had to tote than learn it through the own cross that I'm having it to. So, in our Bible study, what have we learned? Number one, to hear from God. Hear from God. I believe we've heard from God in this corporate vision. We want to see this church grow. How many would like to see this church grow? How many is doing something about seeing this church grow? Are you inviting people weekly? Are you witnessing to people? Are you doing your part? Don't come to church thinking you're going to sit under somebody else's praise down blessing. I'm going to get close to so-and-so. Maybe some nigga lowered your father. Pray your own blessing up.
Amen.
You got all week long. You got just as much as time as anybody else here. When you leave them doors, get in your prayer closet. Begin to seek the Lord and say, Lord, I want to be blessed. Yeah. And watch him do the supernatural in your life.
Don't come up here talking about Brother Brandon. I just don't know. Here lately, but don't Brother Brandon mean. Well, do what you're supposed to be doing. I like what Brother Ralph said Sunday night when he called. He said, let's don't be hearers of the word only. I wonder how many gallons of gas we've wasted going down the road. Going out and hearing good teaching, good preaching, and then just not do it. If we're going to hear it, and we believe that God has given these messages, then let's start doing what the word says. From this time forward, I want all of us that believes in Old Grove Assembly of God, I got to get to church believing in the church. That's my job. Because if you don't believe in this church, you ain't going to work for what you don't believe in. But if you believe in this church, if you believe in your pastor, how many believes in their pastor tonight? I believe in you. You believe in me, and I believe in you, and we encourage one another, then we can do it.
Amen.
Believe in your church. Hear from God, because I want to hear some of your individual visions and dreams come true. You know what I would love to hear? Some Wednesday nights or Sunday nights, when we're having a chance to testify, that you stand up and testify that maybe one of your lost loved ones that you prayed for gave their heart to Jesus. How many still prays for the lost? Does a lost burden your heart? If they don't, man, you may be lost yourself. Paul had such an intimacy about the lost, he told God he wished himself was accursed. Now, how many of us that close tonight? I ain't. My lost loved one won't go. They ain't gonna change my mind. I still want to go to heaven. Amen. But that's just the intimacy that Paul had with the lost. He said, if the house of Israel can't be saved, if some of the lost sheep of the house of Israel, he said, count me accursed. What? Moses said the same thing. Moses had such an intimacy with the lost, he told the Lord, he said, if you won't forgive these, blot my name out your book. I don't know about y'all, but I hope I don't ever get that close. I don't want to get that close. Lord, I want to go to heaven. All them other folk want to go to hell. That's their choice. I pray for them. God bless them. I love them. I witness to them. But if they don't serve you and they don't accept you, I'm just going to shake the dust off my feet and go to somebody else. But we can glean from that and take and get the big picture of the intimacy that he had for the lost. Amen. And our Bible study tonight is obey. If God gives you a vision, obey it. Amen. Let's bow our heads.